All right. Want to help me? I'll grab it too. You want to help me?
Yeah.
All right, folks, we're in the next three-story building. This building is round on the top, flat on the bottom. It's designed to deflect an overhead blast. Top floor is the crew's quarters. You've been in the Air Force or the military, you know it's not the Hilton, it's the military. There's two bunk beds, kitchenette, and a bathroom. Downstairs is the equipment bay. This floor is launch control. This is where we launch from. This is where we spend most of our time. The last thing we need to worry about is a shock wave. A nearby detonation will create an incredible earthquake. It'll make the land above our heads look like waves on the ocean. We need to survive that. Everything critical to launching this missile, the people, the equipment, the missile itself, are all on giant springs and shock absorbers. You'll see them everywhere, including all three floors of this building. We're not attached to the walls. We're just hanging here by any of these massive springs around the room. So in case of that shock wave, the ground around us, shell of the building itself, can all move up and down a foot and a half, a foot side to side. We should just hang here safe in our little cocoon. Four crew members, two officers, two enlisted, here for the next 24 hours. That's our ship. We call it an alert. It's our job to decode secret messages, monitor, maintain the missile in the complex, troubleshoot any problems that arise, keep this place in a state of readiness. That missile has to be ready to fire every second of every day. First crew member is a missile combat crew commander. You're captain in the Air Force. You're the boss. You're responsible for all of us and all of this for the next 24 hours. You have the weight of the world on your shoulders. That order comes through to launch. It's up to the commander here. Make sure we launch. You're the deputy missile combat crew commander, first and second lieutenant. Communication officer. You have four different kinds of radios connected to seven different antennas you'll see up topside. Redundancy. You're also the safety officer, and your most important job is taking care of that clock. There's no wires going to it. It's not electric. Electric clocks are not reliable enough for our needs. It's an 8-day wind-up chronometer. It's been running since 1963. Deputy on duty every Sunday morning winds it. Twice a day, every day, synchronize that with the atomic clock that's in Boulder, Colorado. Your clock can never be more than 1 second off. This is our launch clock. The launch clock is set to Zulu time. Zero meridian, where the time zones start. All our nuclear forces run on Zulu time. It avoids confusion. We don't need to care if it's AM, PM, daylight savings time, because it's the same time for all our nuclear forces, no matter where on earth they are. Right now, it's about 4:15 in the afternoon for everybody. By military terms, 1,715 hours, no confusion. Last two crew members are the enlisted people, the workers, the most technically trained people on the crew. First one is the MFT, Missile Facilities Technician. They take care of the facilities. They keep us alive, keep that missile alive. We have 9 floors out there, jam-packed with anything you think a liquid fuel rocket could need. This person takes care of all that stuff like a jack of all trades. The last crew member is the BMAT, Ballistic Missile Analyst Technician, the computer expert, the electronic technician. That's what I did. I was responsible for all the launch equipment, the missile itself, the guidance system, and the warhead. My job is to make sure the missile works. Sat out there for 20 years. Stick your car in the garage for 20 years, give it a shot. See how you make out. We can't try it, test it, or start it, because if we start up the engines, we started World War III. But from here, I can test everything but the engine. My main job on this crew would be doing a launch. Something goes wrong, it's on my shoulders to run down that cableway, figure out what went wrong, fix it. Make it launch or die trying, whichever one's going to happen first. Some of our equipment, this runs the facilities, my launch equipment, breakers for everything below ground. This is called the MGAC, Missile Guidance Alignment Checkout Group. This is the interface with the guidance computer that sits on the missile. This thing tells the missile, one, where it is, two, where it's going to go. In order to hit a target somewhere in China or Russia, that missile has to know where true north is at all times. The MGAC is what shows it. Anybody around my age who knows anything about computers may recognize this as a paper bootstrap. This is how we used to talk to computers. We didn't have a keyboard, a joystick, Windows, we had this. We stole it from the player piano era, from the 1800s. We used it until 1987. This is how we put our targeting coordinates in. The greatest thing about this ancient technology, it'll keep its programming forever, and it's unhackable. This is called the annunciator panel. You'll hear it in a couple minutes. That's our security system. I told you, the only camera on the property is watching the phone in the cage. Make sure nobody has a gun to the commander's head when he's trying to get us in. No cameras up topside, no security either. All we have is these things called tipsies. You'll see them, the little silver poles with the half moons, Doppler radar. sending out a radio beam. Cross it, we're going to get an alarm. Eight of them got the silo closure door, two of them got our air supply. You break that beam, alarms are going off, the big gray thing back there in the corner, that's called the blast valve. That valve is connected to our only air shaft. It'll slam close, it'll cut off our air, so nobody can kill us while we're down here. It also slams close during a launch, or if it detects a nearby detonation, protect us from the radiation. We're not like a submarine, we don't manufacture air here. That valve closes, all we have left to breathe, whatever's left in here. These alarms go off, you get on the phone, call the base. They'll send out a roving two-person team, see what's going on. No questions asked, use the deadly force. We're not going out there. We don't know what's out there. We're not going to open the doors and let the enemy in. They'll come. They're never more than 20 minutes away if we really need them. This panel is our fail-safe. Every nuclear weapon has a fail-safe. The Air Force installed that to stop an inadvertent launch, either accidental, a crew that went crazy, or a crew that had been infiltrated. It's called the Butterfly Control Valve Lock. It's just a combination lock. Connected to this. This is a cutaway of a butterfly valve. It just butterflies open and lets the fuels flow. Four of these valves on the first stage engine, two on the oxidizer lines, two on the propeller line. The Titan II runs on a hypergolic fuel. Hypergolic means ignites on contact. We don't need a fuse, match, or spark plug to light that rocket on. This valve gets the signals, four of them swing open, two fuels mix, there's an instant explosion, and we get liftoff. One of the valves has a locking mechanism connected to this. This valve can't open, none of them can open. They can't open, we can't launch. You think you're going to go start World War III on your own someday? Went out there, try to manually make it open? It has an explosive housing, it'll explode. It'll melt closed. A rocket will never launch after that, it's useless. The only way to get it to open is to put that combination in. Now the captain doesn't know it. You don't know it, do you? Deputy doesn't know it, and the base doesn't know it. Only Strategic Air Command knows it. You'll only ever see it if the Soviets have launched a nuclear strike, we were ordered to retaliate. 17 million possible combinations, Captain. You gonna guess that? Captain, you gonna guess that? No, the answer is no. Because if you try on the seventh wrong try, that'll melt down. It'll never work again. We're no longer in a state of readiness. You're no longer a captain in the Air Force. We're going to end this thing. It has a seal. It's the only thing connected to the outside world. This silo is unhackable. But if we touch a dial, the base knows about it and you're in trouble. Typical day of work, 7 in the morning. All the missile crews meet at this top secret bunker on the base in Tucson. They give us a top secret briefing. Talk to us about anything going on around the world they think we should know about. Troop movement, military buildup, political problems. The end of the meeting, jump in our trucks, drive out to the silos, replace the crews we're there for 24 hours. They take our truck, they drive back, we seal ourselves in. First thing we do, check everything. Go through this place with a fine-tooth comb. Takes 4 hours. 12 hours later, we get up, do it again. Twice a day, every day, this place has gone through head-to-toe looking for problems. That'll chew up 8 out of our 24-hour shift. It gives us 16 hours to go. You're going to see signs painted on the walls. No loan zone. SAC two-man policy. You ever hear of the buddy system for like swimming? This is a buddy system for working with nuclear weapons. It's about safety. It's about trust. I'm watching you, lady. You're watching me. You go back there, Captain, you go too. Someone goes out that blast door. Someone's in your hip pocket right next to you. This room is manned every second of every day by at least one officer and one enlisted. There's always two people in here. You can't have anybody sabotaging it, stealing and selling our top secret information, or worse, one of us goes nuts, wants to end the world, they're going to try to launch it. We watch each other. It's like a fishbowl down here. The only place you can be alone, upstairs in the crew's quarters. We each had 4 hours. Go take a nap, cook something to eat. Just get away from the stress, the tension, and the noise of this room for a bit. Say it's 3 a.m, we've been down here for like 20 hours. We're sealed in. There's no radio, there's no television, there's no news. We locked those doors behind us, we've locked out all access to the world. No idea what's going on up there. All we know, what the Air Force decides to tell us, comes from these two speakers connected to all your radio. The top speaker's connected to Strategic Air Command Headquarters, Omaha, Nebraska. Bottom speaker's connected to the 15th Air Force Headquarters, Riverside, California. If the Soviets had launched a nuclear strike, destroyed that base, we'll get the message from the other one. You destroy that one too, wipe out Washington, D.C., kill the president. We have a flying command post, codenamed Looking Glass. We refer to it as a doomsday plane. Every second of every day, there are generals and admirals in the skies over America, safe from a nuclear attack. They can give us the orders to retaliate, combinations we need to launch. They're always up there, folks, after right the second. Strategic Air Command. They were in charge of all our nuclear weapons. Doesn't matter what branch of the service. So they send out a message that goes out to all of us at the same time. The Titan IIs, the Minutemen missiles, all the bombers, all our nuclear submarines. Message may be for one of them, may be for us. It could be a test, could be a simulation. We don't know, they all sound the same. So until we get the message, write it down and then decode it, we're not sure what's going on. But crews are trained to believe. You hear this alarm you're about to hear, it means it could be World War III. You better bank on it. Drop what you're doing. Get the control center. Decode the message. Figure out what's going on. First thought goes through a crew member's mind when this thing goes off. Oh my God, this is it. Every time that alarm goes off, you literally jump out of your skin because we've been trained to believe this is it. Now, it can also be pretty boring down here. Four of us down here for 24 hours staring at each other. Basically just sitting here, waiting for an order to come from that speaker, from the president, tell us to end the world, hoping it never does. But the boredom is punctuated by moments of sheer terror every time this goes off. That is a preamble to an emergency action message. All your radios are going on. Captain has a top secret emergency action message book, so does our deputy. Crack it open, there's a couple top secret forms in here. They each have a grease pencil. They're going to read off a 41 character message. You're both going to copy it down in your books. Then you exchange your books, they'll repeat the message, you copy it down again. Then you put the two books, together and you make sure they're exactly the same. When it comes to nuclear weapons in America, two people need to agree to do anything. Not even a president can run off and make some crazy decision on his own. People have to agree with him. Part of our checks and balances. We're going to decode this. Unfortunately for us today, I guarantee this is the one message no crew member ever wanted to receive. This is the real deal. There's only two places we can get a launch order from. One is the president, and if he's dead, the doomsday plane. We have to make sure it came from one of those two sources. We need to authenticate this message. This now allows us to go to that red safe. That's our emergency war order safe for our go-to-war safe. One of the most top-secret documents in America was held in that safe. It's called the PSYOPs, our nuclear battle plan. The battle plan for every nuclear weapon America possessed and what to do with them was held in that safe. That book is incredibly top-secret. It's the most top-secret thing about this place. It's still top-secret to this day. We got in that book with our lives. Going to pull that book out? Take out 24 of these authenticated cards that are kept in there. Choose the one that corresponds to the first two characters of that message. Say it's this one, Delta Foxtrot. These are made out of hard plastic. We call it the cookie. Crack open the cookie. Pull out the authenticated card. You ever hear of the nuclear football? Officer follows around the president 24-7, has a briefcase handcuffed to him with the launch codes in it. This is what's in that briefcase. These are the launch codes. You're going to line that up with both your books. You're going to make sure it lines up exactly. If it does, if you agree, it's authenticated, it came from the president, we can order to launch. Message itself, tell us what page in the PSYOP book to go to, what battle are we fighting. There's all different scenarios in that book based on what they think the Soviets have already launched at us. We're going to that plan. It's going to tell you what time to launch. You take your grease pencil, write the time with big numbers across the face of your clock so we don't make a mistake. This is synchronized to the second. There are 54 Titan IIs about to fly over the North Pole. There are 1,000 Minutemen missiles going over the North Pole. All our nuclear submarines are firing off hundreds of their missiles. All our bombers are getting airborne. They're flying over the North Pole. All can't go at the same time. It has to go exactly when it has to go. That's why your clock has to be so accurate. Captain, the message is going to tell you which of our three pre-programmed targets you're aiming at. You're going to punch it in there. And it's going to give you the combination of the butterfly valve for the first time ever. You read it off to me. I'll enter the combination here, break the seal, flip this up, hit that switch. If I get a green light, means they gave me a good code, the butterfly valve's unlocked, and we're about to launch. Now we know a couple other things at this point. We know if we've been ordered to launch by the president, it means the Soviets have already launched. It only takes 30 minutes for a nuclear missile to reach anywhere in America from Russia. That's it, any moment of any day. Right at the very moment, there are 1,600 active nuclear warheads that are never more than 30 minutes away from completely destroying America. In that 30-minute flight, NORAD, North American Air Defense, has to spot the launchers on the radar. Take the time to verify their actual missiles, not a glitch or mistake, which has happened. Then you've got to get the President, Joint Chief of Staff, Head of Security Council up in the sky where they're safe, and they need to figure out what's going on. What have the Soviets done? What have they launched at us? What are we going to do? How do we retaliate? What battle are we fighting? break open the football, send out the codes to Strategic Air Command, Doomsday Plane, 15th Air Force, and they need to broadcast out over all the radios, the launch codes, the Titan IIs, the Minutemen, the bombers, and the nuclear subs. That's going to take them 20 to 25 minutes to figure all that stuff out, at least, before we even get the first message, which gives us a 5-minute warning. It gives us 5 minutes to launch. It gives us 5 minutes left to live here. We're the first target. Russians don't want this thing going back and wiping out an entire city. They're trying to catch us napping. They're trying to catch these still in the silo. We're not going to let that happen. We're launching. You ready?
Uh-huh.
Hang on. Don't touch him. All right. Here we go. Where do we launch missiles in America with big red buttons, folks? Hollywood, folks. Hollywood. Every movie you ever see, somebody's hitting a big red button. No idea how they came up with that, because the two big red buttons just tell us the doors are open, that's all. In the real world, we use keys. There's a set of keys in that safe. Captain's key goes here. Deputy, your key's over here. Keys are angled. They're 7.5 feet apart, so one person can't reach both. Spring loaded to the off position, just like the ignition in your car. You can't turn one and go turn the other. Have to go exactly at the same time. You ready now? Put your left hand on the keys. Just don't turn them yet. All right, Captain, you're the boss. You're going to give your deputy a countdown. 3, 2, 1, launch, on launch. You got to turn them clockwise. You need to hold them until I tell you to let them go.
Okay. 3, 2, 1, launch.
Turn them, hold them. Takes 5 seconds. Hold it. All right, you can let go. You did your job. You did what the Air Force paid you to do. You just joined World War III. Don't do it again. Let it go.
Let the key go.
The president calls now and says, stop it, we made a huge mistake, too bad. There's no oops button, there's no self-destruct, there's no way to stop it. The keys are turned, this is going to launch. This is the launch sequence. First light, launch enable. Launch enable means everything's been checked, everything's a go. Second light, batteries activated. Two batteries sitting on the missile being force-fed electrolytes for the first time. Takes 28 seconds to fill them up. Once they're full, you get ABS power light. That means the batteries are charged. Silo's off. The door just lifted up, slid open, went to the tips. He set off the alarm. Silo's wide open now. The next lane is Garnet's go. Garnet's computer's talking to the MGAC for the last time. It's getting its coordinates. Where's it going? How does it get there? What does it do when it reaches that point? Fire engines. The butterfly valve just opened. The two fuels mix. That rocket is lit up out there. All your fire alarms are going off, Captain. When the missile gets to 77% of its full thrust, the four explosive bolts that hold it down explode, and the Titan II starts lumbering up out of that silo. 2 seconds later, liftoff, it's on its way. 58 seconds, folks, that's all this takes to launch is 58 seconds, which means it takes less than a minute to end the world. This is what made it so frightening to the Russians. The previous missile, Titan I, they get a message, have to run out there, fill it up with fuel, raise it out of the ground on an elevator, try to launch it. That would take a half hour. They only had 5 minutes. They're all vulnerable, they're all targeted, they weren't afraid of them. Titan II with the hyperbolic fuel, as long as that silo stays at 60 degrees at all times, our missile can sit out there fueled up indefinitely, ready to go at a moment's notice. So it only takes us 3 minutes from the time you get the message till it's on its way, which gives us 2 minutes to say our prayers down here, because we know one's incoming. Whether they can hit us or not, we have no idea. But they only have to miss by less than a mile to take us up. First thing, Captain has buttons, puts out all the fires in the silo. Call the base, tell them we had a successful launch. MFT's closing the silo, close your door, try to buy us some added protection. I need to kill the power with everything below ground but this room. We'll wait it out, see what happens. Three possibilities. They miss us by 100 miles or so. We're going to try to sit down here for up to 30 days. We're going to wait further orders. We're going to let the radiation dissipate, and then we're going to try to climb up. Into what? Whatever's left. We have no idea. Nothing down here tells us what happened out there. They land one within a mile, we're instantly vaporized, it's the end of our problem. Or they miss us by 10, 20, 30 miles away, we're covered in so much debris that we can't get out. We're trapped, we're entombed here forever. We have 30 days of food and water stored in cans down below. At the most, there's 30 days available because the blast route flows. We only have enough diesel fuel to have light for 2 more hours, and then 4 of us are sitting down here in the dark with 2 pistols and 6 bullets each, if we decide to take that route, instead of suffocating to death. But it's no better for you folks. All we know is what's going on with the missile. Headed towards Target 2. Target 2 is the default target. It was always aimed at Target 2. Target 2 is top secret in 1963. It remains top secret to this day because chances are we still have something aimed at Target 2. We didn't know what Target 2 was. We had one of the highest top secret security clearances you can obtain from the government to do this job. We didn't have the need to know. If we actually launch this thing right now, say at Moscow, 30 minutes from now, it's going to kill 12 million people instantly. 12 million people with a turn of a key. They didn't want to put that on the cruise. They didn't want to make it any harder than it had to be turning the keys, knowing who those poor people were. Made a difference. Can't speak for every crew, but my crew, we didn't talk about it. We didn't want to know. All we know is what happens when we get there. Titan II is going 800 miles into space over the North Pole. Four times higher than the space station flies. It hits its apogee, its highest point. Bomb starts arming itself, traveling at 17,000 miles per hour. Travels up to 6,500 miles away and lands on Target 2. Target 2 is set for a ground burst, the original bunker buster. We're going to dig something out of the ground. Missile silo, command center made the bunker under the Kremlin. Bomb detonates right when it hits the ground, instantaneously blowing a crater in the earth, 3/4 of a mile wide, 450 feet deep, right rising whatever's there. Looks like you got hit by an asteroid. Now, depending on what the Soviets have done, if they launch a full-scale nuclear attack like everything, we're going to shoot everything right back at them. We're not shooting at their silos now. We're shooting at their cities now. We're going to take the 54 Titan IIs with the 9 million tons of TNT on board. We're going to completely wipe off the face of the Earth 54 of the Russians' largest cities and every living creature in them. Retaliation, the doomsday scenario, the end of the world. Captain's going to be ordered to switch from Target 2 to 1 and 3. Targets 1 and 3 are set for an air burst. An air burst is much worse than a ground burst. An air burst is what we use to wipe out entire cities. Now the bomb detonates 14,000 feet above the ground. In 1/1,000,000th of a second, it's going to create a 3-mile-wide fireball. That fireball is 10 million degrees. It's brighter than 100 suns. And then at 10 times the speed of sound, shockwave, blastwave, and the heatwave fire out. Just the wind, 7,000 mile per hour blast of wind. That is going to completely wipe out 900 square miles of Earth. 900. The bombs we dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki destroyed 5 square miles. This is 900. That's a city 30 miles across. My city, your city, any city. Beijing, Moscow, Washington are instantly gone. Every major American city is instantly gone. Every major city around the world is instantly gone. Whoever lives in those cities, they're gone. And then for miles and miles beyond that, fires are raging, homes are burning, people are igniting. This is a devastating weapon. Earth has never seen anything like this thing. This is what we thought we needed to keep the Soviets at bay. Keep them from starting World War III to keep the peace. The good news, obviously, never got a message or turned a key. The simplest plan you can possibly imagine to keep you all safe is called MAD. Mutually Assured Destruction. I told you, there's 1,600 warheads aimed at us, right from just from Russia. We have 1,600 aimed at them. No way anyone can win a nuclear war. Everybody knows that. So MAD says, as long as everybody knows they can't win one, well, hopefully, no one will ever be crazy enough to try. That's the plan, folks. That's all there is. And it's worked perfectly so far. But it depends on no one out there being crazy enough to try. You see what's going on in the news? We honestly can't say that any longer. In fact, right now, we're closer to a nuclear war today than we've ever been in our history. For 24 years, Titan II is America's biggest, baddest deterrent, and all the men and the women that serve down here did our jobs, accomplished our mission of peace, peace through deterrence. The crews we sent out to Vandenberg Air Force Base to test launch these out of their silos reported back to the rest of us. They couldn't hear it or feel it take off. That's how isolated this room is from that rocket down the table way. So you gotta go make sure it's still down there, right?